We could always delete if we, All right. So I don't know if anybody's out there. Hey, everyone. Jeff Lafferty, and it's the ArtCast something, something, something. I don't know what number it is. I thought I'd just do a live show. I got my friend Mike Fleming here with me.
Hey everyone, how's it going?
Sorry, let me just turn off the sound.
Oh yeah, I'll let you worry about all that, man. I don't.
Yeah, I'll just have it open. Oh wait, Dave Forbes in the chat. Hey Dave.
Holy cow, that was
But
quick.
yeah, we thought we thought we would do a live show for a change, because we haven't done a live show in a long time. Oh my.
Yeah, it's we haven't even talked. I mean, we talked for just a couple minutes now, but I haven't
We
talked
had a
to you, and
massive
like I haven't talked to you in a minute, man.
falling out when you tried to steal my wife. Still fucking broke up about
It's that damn drive that ruined everything.
that. No, but yeah, we haven't done a long show in like a long time.
Yeah, we haven't even talked in at least almost a year, I would say.
Really, has it been that? No, we. I mean, what about when we were doing the Twitch thing? That wasn't like a year ago, was
Oh
it?
yeah, that's right. That was maybe like October or something. You're right.
Yeah. So we did a little attempt at Twitch for a little while.
Yeah, we didn't do too bad. We did
Yeah.
like maybe 10 or 15 shows, I would say.
Yeah.
But I
Like a
think that
good.
just the technical aspect of that just killed us.
That's what I was gonna say. It was like five shows to just actually get the first show up, but
Then like,
was really.
neither one of our computers could handle it, and I was like wrapping ice packs around the power
Right.
adapters. It's just craziness.
Right. Yeah, I don't know why that site, man. It's just like our computers just chug. I mean, it's funny because we're doing the exact same thing here and it's streaming fine. I
Yeah, and
don't get it.
I've got like HD and everything on too. I don't know. I think it's just because that site is made for like video gaming and like super high-end machines and all these things. And
That
like
could be.
the art is kind of,
Yeah.
oh yeah, let's include the artists. I don't know. I might be wrong about that, but
Yeah, it didn't really seem like there was much honestly going on in that creative place or whatever that we were streaming in.
yeah.
I mean, there was a few people that would drop by, but not nothing like special, I guess.
Yeah, and we did invest a lot of time in like figuring out how to do like little banners and get that XSplit thing working and
Oh yeah. I
subscribing to
forgot
the
about that.
services and all
Yeah.
that stuff.
Yeah. Got $30 out of me for that or something.
Yeah.
I think I still have that subscription too.
I know.
Which that's
I just thought about it myself. I was like, I bet.
That thing doesn't work bad for like recording the screen though, like as a screen capture if you ever gotta do a re screen recorded video, which I don't do very often, but every now and then I find a reason I need one.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I see what you're
So.
saying. For like a, just like a video you could upload later.
Right, yeah, just download or record straight to your hard drive or something.
Yeah.
But I was gonna say, because I sent you those airbrushes, and I was actually gonna ask you, since we were talking before we started, like, you think those are gonna work out for you or what?
I think they might. There's a, I think I could get all the parts from, it seemed like there was three and then there was one who was a different style. Three were the same and one was different, I think. But yeah, I'm definitely going to, I had to go, I have to try and find a hose adapter that'll work, because the hose I have, it's neither hose that I have will work for it.
Right.
I do have a couple of airbrushes. I got one before I left. It's called a Neo by Iwata,
Okay.
and I had an old compressor my dad had when I was when I was younger, and I've been using that, but it's like it sounds like a it's super loud. It sounds like literally like a lawnmower is in the room with you,
Oh
but
man.
it's just this tiny little thing too, and I was just like, man, this is crazy. And you couldn't control like the pressure,
Oh yeah.
even though like the you know, the airbrush is dual action, it it's still like you just got this constant. So you can't really control the air, I guess. At least I haven't figured out how to, by just using the airbrush.
Some of those smaller compressors are like that, where they're just, you know, you can't dial the pressure down or up. It's, you know, you can't even kind of get it set to where, I don't know if they're just made for airbrushes, and so they just figure, well, you know, whatever's coming out is enough or what.
Yeah, and I think, and especially like, it seemed like you needed, and I made it work for, you know, every, you know, I did the Teenage Turtle Head and that thing I did for my mom. Those are the only two things I've really used it on. And it worked. It worked good. I mean, good enough to paint those. But I recently got a Neo Air, which is a little tiny air compressor. But it's got three settings on it. And it, and I got it, like, cool, you know, got it pretty cheap at Hobby Lobby. And then they got that coupon deal too, so it's like pretty good deal. So
that's awesome.
I haven't been able to use it yet, but
yeah, I've never heard of that kind. But
I actually got it right here. It's really small. It's like this big, and then it's got three settings, and it's got like the little holder here. And it's really quiet too. It's got these little, rubber feet, and you can't even hear it running, like, really.
Yeah, that thing's little, dude. That's awesome. And that kicks out enough air to run an airbrush, huh?
Yeah, it works. Works great, man. Like this is high, and it shoots really well, I think.
Oh, cool.
Definitely has more power than the other one that my dad had. And then
hold your airbrush up so I can check it out. Oh, cool. That one looks good.
Yeah, that's nice. Great.
Nice.
And then it came with a little cup too, which I don't really use a whole lot, but
yeah, that one's tiny. Wow. Yeah, that's awesome. I didn't think you had one.
I didn't. When you first emailed me, I didn't have one.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah.
So you were like out in New York or something, right?
Yeah. I was out in New York. But no, I think there's still lots of stuff in those that you sent me that I'll definitely be able to use.
Yeah. Yeah. That guy, I mean, he sent me, you know, like a bunch of them, and then there was like there were some parts on there that fit mine, and I took those out. It's actually really helped my airbrush to work a hell of a lot better. But then there was this, the other ones, you know, were like, you know, different makes and stuff. And I just thought, you know, I'm not going to end up using those. So I thought maybe you'd want one of them.
Yeah. So. Some of them definitely seem like there definitely needs to be some cleaning done. I mean, definitely they look like they're in good condition and will definitely work. They just need, you know, a little bit of mineral spirits and some time and some love.
Yeah. Yeah.
But whoever sent that to you, big thanks to them.
Yeah, that was neat. So I was wondering about that New York trip. You want to talk about that at all? I just was kind of curious. Was there any grand adventures out there?
Yeah, I mean, there were some. Like, it was mostly just working, but we did go. Like, I did go to Manhattan twice. It's you know, it's a whole different world that I've ever been exposed to out there.
Yeah,
I don't know if you've been out there before, but it's just insane, man.
Really?
I don't know how else to even describe it.
Yeah, I've never been to the East Coast. I've been on the West Coast to bigger cities, but like not New York, that's for sure.
Yeah, it's insane. So we were working in Brooklyn. And I was staying, like, the hotel we were at was in Staten Island, or on Staten Island, I guess. And it took me a while to even figure out, like, okay, there's New Jersey. Like, everything's so close. Like, you could travel states just to get to work, you know what I mean? And people do it all the time.
Yeah.
But it was just insane, man. A city that large, I mean, when we were coming in on the plane, I could see the Statue of Liberty and just, like, nothing but endless buildings just everywhere. It's just incredible, actually.
Yeah.
And seeing the Statue of Liberty like in person was crazy.
Yeah.
I didn't get to go up to it or go in it or anything, but I did get on the what do they call that ferry? The Staten Island Ferry, I think.
Yeah.
I did get on that, and then that takes you right past it to go, you know, to Manhattan, which is really the only way to really get there without spending, you know, $9,000.
Yeah.
Like every bridge and everything has like this, you know, every time you went over a bridge, it was like $13.
Holy shit.
Yeah, like the tolls there are just insanity, man. You had to have three people in the car to go into the HOV lanes.
Jeez.
Yeah, it was fun, but I mean, it was just crazy. And I'm glad I wasn't paying for the all the tolls and stuff, because we racked them up every day. We were going through two or three of them.
Wow.
And it took a pain. And work wasn't that far, but I mean, traffic. It took like an hour each day to get there, and you know, just traffic to getting work and back.
What like part of like the city where you're trying to get into, where you guys were working?
Just Brooklyn. We were trying to get to the Brooklyn, like the Brooklyn East docks really is where it was. Or the docks. And we were working on the New York wheel, which is, it's going to be the largest Ferris wheel in the world. It's going to be bigger than the London Eye. And we were inspecting all the welds, all the welds on the lakes that were getting ready to be put up. Like they got the plate. They're going to put it, they're building it on Staten Island. They're inspecting everything and doing repairs and all that. And
yeah.
So we're in like a rough part of Brooklyn.
Yeah.
Working on the thing.
That's pretty cool, though. That's pretty neat.
Yeah. It was a neat project. I mean, it was very similar to, like very similar to the work I did at Vestas, except instead of doing our measurements and you know using the European measuring system we had to switch it to the American standard, which was a bit of an adjustment. Going from millimeters to inches, which that took me a minute to get used to, and then to figure everything out on the machines was a little, the machine was a little bit different than what I used it at Vestas, but.
Yeah.
Once you got it all down, then it was, you start flying.
Yeah. Is that how you ended up getting like a job like that? Just because you worked there, people you knew and stuff or what?
Yeah. Basically just, networking in the NDT world.
Yeah.
They wanted to find people to do that job in the city, but out of 9 million people,
right.
They couldn't find anyone, so they flew me in from Colorado, and then they flew in these other guys from Texas. Three other dudes, and we worked on the project together. And it was a cool gig, man. I mean, it sucked, but there's a lot of cool people there, and you know, I'd never really been around people that had like New York accents or Boston accents, and it was kind of neat.
Yeah.
Just like everywhere you went, no one cares about anyone.
Really?
We were playing this game where as we were driving around, we would just wave to people, and you get a point if you get someone to wave back. Nobody ever won.
Yeah, I'm bad, actually. That is kind of funny, because like I know where I grew up, everybody, that's just like something everybody does, is that everybody waves at each other.
Yeah.
Especially when I was a kid. It was like back then it was like everybody waved to each other. I guess not so much now, but
yeah, and then even people that are like, you would think are being paid to like be nice, like gas station attendants and like even them. Like, hey, how's your day going? Nothing. Like, okay. Well, keep living.
That sucks. Oh man.
Nah, but there are some nice people there. I'm just playing. But for the majority, I mean, it was like that a lot of the time. The people at the hotel were really nice, though.
There you go. So they have you set up at like a nice place, or just like some flea bag place or something?
where they first had us stay, that was in New Jersey, and that was a horrible. It's like right on the edge of the highway, and just like trucks whizzing by, like huge. Like you couldn't get any sleep, and there's like drug deals going on, and it's just like, oh man, wasn't a good place. And we like we complained to the boss, and he put us on a. Well, there was these other guys on the job, and they were already at the hotel in Staten Island.
Yeah.
So he was like, I need everyone to be at the same building anyway, like the guy who was leading the thing.
Yeah.
Which she was an awesome person. His name was Lou, and I love that guy. He was great. But he was like, I want everyone to be in the same place anyway. So we called the guy that hired us to bring us out there, and he put us in that place, which was like way, you know, I think it was $80 a night in Jersey, and then in on Staten Island at that nicer hotel, which was like a Hilton, it was $140 a night.
Mm.
And we were there for 5 weeks, and it was four dudes, so it was a pretty hefty bill.
Yeah. It's funny, $80 actually doesn't sound that much. I mean, the last time me and Tanya went somewhere, I don't think we could find a place less than that, even around here.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like we went up to the mountains and stuff, and we drove like all over the place looking for reasonable, you know, hotels and stuff. Everything wanted to be like over $100.
Jeez. Was it just because, well, you're in Boulder though, right?
Well, I know, but we were like kind of going down, you know, I mean, the ski resorts, but still there's places like Rifle and Craig and all that kind of area. And you'd think like Craig would be fucking cheap, but even there it was just like, man, you know.
Yeah, I hear you.
Maybe it was just a popular weekend or something when we were up there. I don't remember. I was surprised, though.
Yeah, I mean, I know in Pueblo, I mean, there are a couple of hotels where they charge, you know, a crazy amount of money to stay there. But, like, you could get $45 a night in lots of places.
$45 a night, really?
Yeah, even in Denver, there was a few of those. I mean, obviously, they're not going to be great. But,
yeah. Yeah. I don't understand at those places.
Yeah.
Sometimes it ran them by like the hour or something, right?
Yeah, I didn't even know those existed until I went to New York. I was like, oh, right. Wow. By the hour, yeah. Huh? I wonder what's going on here.
That's cool, though.
Yeah, but it was a cool gig, man. It was a fun, it's a cool project to be a part of too, because they had like, you know, they had like the decals of it, like when you were getting on the ferry, they would say, there was like these signs everywhere that said New York Wheel coming soon, and you know,
yeah,
they had pictures of the thing up everywhere, and you know, it's going to be definitely a major part of the skyline there now. Like each pod is made out of glass, and they can hold like 40 people.
Wow. And like each little seat that goes around is like a 40 person room or something.
Yeah. It's like a glass pod that overlooks the water and Statue of Liberty and everything.
That's neat.
Yeah, it is. It's going to be pretty, pretty sweet. And you know, it's going to be humongous too. And all we were doing was like, there was all these leg pieces that are going to hold up the main structure. And, that's what we were inspecting all the welds on, which it was made like the steel and everything. It was inspected and welded in China, or not in China, in Italy, I guess. And they had already had a bunch of Italian inspectors do what we were doing.
Yeah.
But the New York like mayor and city council and all that, they didn't have any. Like I guess paperwork or something, or they just didn't accept their work. Like the city wouldn't accept the Italians' work, like the inspection work. So they said, "No, we need to redo all that."
Oh, wow.
So that's why they brought us in.
Were you guys doing it like while it's up? So you were like going up high, or was this all on the ground? Or
well, they were laying down, but they were on these big metal like these big steel like beams. So that like they could easily put them on a barge or whatever those big boats are called,
yeah,
and like move it around. So it was, you know, we had to climb up, you know, probably 25 feet in the air to get inside the thing. And then, you know, you couldn't rotate it like we could at Vestas. Like, you could spin them on these, they called them Romars. So you could, like if you had to inspect the top, you could roll it down and inspect it, you know, which we didn't have that here. So we had to have the separate crew who were brought on just to be our scaffold guys. So they had to move, like, whenever we were done in an area, they had to tear down the scaffold and move it and rebuild it and all that.
Wow.
Yeah, it was crazy. And also, those guys were, like, everyone's union, too, so no one would do anything without, like, paperwork. And
really? Wow.
But there were some cool dudes, like, you know. It's just, like, the steelworkers, too, who were, like, that's the property we were on was the steelworkers. Like, you know, that was there. That's where they had them all stored.
Yeah.
And they hated us. And, you know, and welders hate NDT guys anyway.
Right.
Because they always, you know, they find the flaws, so naturally.
Right. Right.
Not a lot of love, but but then on top of that, like, the whole union thing.
Yeah.
Because we weren't union, they didn't like that. And
that's what I was gonna ask, is, like, are you even in, like, a union coming from here?
No, we weren't.
Yeah. So I know back east, especially, like, that union shit can get pretty hairy. But even here, I've run into a little bit of it, you know?
Yeah. I never really dealt with anything like that, like, crazy, you know, at the mill a little bit, but
yeah,
you know, nothing like that we've seen, like, firsthand, really.
Right.
It wasn't, like, nothing crazy. It just, you know, lots of, like, sometimes, like, we'd have to leave the second the scaffold guys were done. Like, if they wanted to have an 8-hour day, we would have to have an 8-hour day.
Yeah.
And they would be like, we're leaving the site now, so we'd have to, like, drop everything and, like, get out.
Right.
Like, no warning, or, I mean, just a bunch of little tiny things like that. Nothing crazy, but.
We used to just, like, we did a lot of government stuff when I worked for Joe, and that was one thing I always hated, was just, like, the, you know what I mean? It's like you get on those kinds of jobs and stuff, and it's, like, all the rules and everything like that you always have to be following, and just gets, you know what I mean?
There's always some guy
in 2 minutes, but yeah.
There's always some guy in a suit and then a hard hat, and he's walking out with a clipboard.
Yeah.
And he's making sure everyone's doing the right thing, or, you know, which I, you know, for safety and all that. But I mean, it seems like at some point there's just, like, you know, this boss is trying to outpower this boss, and it just seems like this ego thing the majority of the time.
Yeah.
Which maybe that's not true everywhere, but what I've experienced, that's how it is.
Right. Totally.
But going into Manhattan, like, we had one day off a week, which was on Sunday.
Yeah.
And I did go to Manhattan twice, and it was cool, man. It was like we went into a play on one of the days.
Yeah.
A play on Broadway, a musical, I guess is what they're called. And that was the first time I'd ever been to one of those, and that was kind of a pretty cool experience. The play was about, it was called Come From Away, I think it was called, and it was about this town in Canada where, like, on 9/11, when a bunch of the planes, when they had to ground a bunch of the planes, a whole bunch of the planes had to go there.
Oh, yeah.
It was about that, like, town, and them, like, accommodating, you know, all the people that had to, you know, that just, you know, it was a really small town, and they had to accommodate all these thousands of people. And that was what the musical was about. Well, she wouldn't think there'd be a lot of material there, but they got a good hour and a half out of it. So it was jam packed with, like, you know, I'd never been in a room with, like, so many people in such a little room, and then, like, the seats are, like, literally, like, crammed on top of each other.
Right. That's neat.
But it was cool. Like, it was pretty cool. Like, my first play too was on Broadway, which, like, that's,
I know. That's,
you know, especially being from Colorado, it's kind of a cool thing.
Yeah. Yeah, I actually was really shocked when, I don't remember, like, why I messaged you on Facebook or whatever, but when you were, like, you know, telling me you're up there, I'm like, seriously?
Yeah, it wasn't in the plans, but but at some point I was just like, man, I can't turn that down. So, right. And the way the guy had the contract was it was going to be the contract was for a minimum of 4 weeks, but a possibility of 3 months.
Yeah.
So I was just like, man, 3 months, that's not that big of a deal. Right. Even if it, you know, it's not the thing that was really sold me. It wasn't like a full-time job at any, you know, it was just a contract gig. So, you know,
yeah,
I was just like, all right. And then I brought, like an idiot, I brought all of my sculpting stuff. One whole suitcase was just devoted to nothing but art. Mm-hmm. I got it there, set it all up, and didn't touch it the entire time I was working. Wow. And then hauled it all back like an idiot.
Just because you didn't have time, or?
Well, just because working was so crazy and hectic. And then, like, you know, whenever you did get a day off, the guys certainly weren't going to let you stay in the hotel room and work. So they're like, how often are you going to be in New York? And I mean, they had a point.
Right.
So it's just like, all right, well.
So did you guys all have to stay like together in like a room, or did they at least give you some rooms, or?
Oh yeah, we each had our own room for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if I could hunt out in a bunk. You know, I'm already seeing these guys, you know, 14, 15
all day. That would be rugged.
But they had cool. I mean, the hotel was pretty neat. It had like its own restaurant, and which the owners, like, they named the restaurant after their dog.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, because they had like their own like DVD that would constantly play if you went to the certain channel. Yeah. And I was checking it out one night, and they were like, you know, talking about the dog, and that was the name of the restaurant, and it was like a 4-star, 5-star restaurant or whatever. And then you know, and then they had like this this like outside area where you can go get married, and
wow,
a party area, and like all these gondolas and like waterfalls, and then like cool. There's just countless like parties happening there, like events. It's just like, you know, beautiful women walking around constantly, and like elegant gowns, and like guys in suits and ties, and like we're walking in with like dirty pants and
right.
Work boots and construction guys.
Right.
Just kind of out of place, but.
Yeah. That's neat.
But the things that were annoying were just annoying because it was like, you know, you're so far away from home. And, but I mean, it was a cool experience. I mean, looking back on it, and, you know, I definitely met a lot of really good like contacts for NDT work, for sure.
Right.
Like, they already had wanted me to go, me and this other guy, they wanted us to go to like, you know, they wanted us to go to Italy. They could have a whole bunch of work there. They had some work in Africa, a bunch of work in Europe. Shit, and I was like, oh man, let me think about it.
Yeah. That's pretty wild, but I can see why you're getting making the big bucks having to travel like that, you know?
Oh yeah, and definitely.
Probably why they got to pay it too, because, you know, I'm sure like not everybody wants to pick up and go to Africa for a while, and, you know, things like that.
There's one that he wanted me to go do, which is probably the only one I'm even considering, but it's like a 6-month pipeline job in California, right next to San Francisco.
Yeah.
And it's a bunch of phased ray work, and that's the only one I'm really considering. Like, I don't really want to go to, I mean, I do want to, but I want to like do art too. So,
right.
I definitely, it would be kind of cool to see Europe, or, you know,
right.
It is kind of awesome to be paid to travel. Like literally as you're sitting on the plane, you're getting paid.
Yeah.
That's kind of neat.
That is pretty neat.
And then once you're there, like everything's paid for. Like literally everything's paid for already, so you don't really have a lot of expense.
Yeah.
But
that's cool. Sounds like an adventure, man.
Yeah, it's definitely a fun little gig, man. It was interesting the whole time. Like there's like, except on the job. Like, I mean, the job was pretty dull, but the guys who we worked with were pretty neat. There were some characters just like any other job, and there were some guys that, you know, knew it all, just like anywhere else. But
yeah,
it was a cool little experience for sure.
Yeah. So when you came back, did you keep your house and everything? You still live in the same place and everything, or?
Yeah, my sister, she was staying here, and I let her use my car and everything while I was gone.
Oh, that's
like,
cool.
Well, one of my sisters anyway. And then I paid for everything while I was gone, of course, but my sister stayed here, and then when I got back, I had a roommate for a few months before I left, but he actually went on the job with me, so.
Mm-hmm.
And then he when we got back, he went back to Texas. So,
oh yeah, that's cool. I didn't see any like sculptures and stuff you've been doing on like Facebook lately. They've been looking pretty cool.
Oh, thanks, man. Yeah, I'm trying to really focus on doing daily work and really getting some stuff done and making content and trying to grow Patreon and trying to make money, because I really don't want to go to that job. I mean, honestly, I don't. I mean, the only reason I kind of do is just because it's a lot of money, but I really would rather just not do it. And the guy knows that too. I mean, he had to really talk to get me to go to that New York job.
Yeah.
And also because my buddy was going, if my roommate wasn't going, then I don't know if I would have went even on that one. But you know, when I did quit Vestas and I had racked up some debt because I wasn't making any money really.
Mm.
So it was a good opportunity to get out of debt.
Right.
So, and then not, you know, not have to sign on for a full-time position anymore.
Right. Well, it sounds like a good deal for what it was, and you know, who knows what happens now. But
yeah, it's kind of
nice to have that option, I guess.
Yeah, it was. It would have been, and then just like turning 30 there too. It just helped me realize that I want to, you know, I don't want to be doing that, and I do want to be doing this. It's just tough to like, you know, start growing. But the only way to do that is just continually do daily work and keep posting, and it's, you know, slow but sure, man. It is working. So,
yeah. Well, I do agree with that. I think that, you know, even though I've been bad about the daily thing lately, it's like that's how you do it. That's how you build an audience that wants your work and buys it and stuff.
Yeah,
for sure.
And then just like continually trying to develop new ideas, and if something doesn't work, and
right,
you know, just keep trying and trying and trying and trying and trying.
Yeah. Which,
and then just to get better too. I mean, you know, I don't feel like I've done a whole lot anyway. So I definitely want to offer more. So.
Yeah. You never stop learning. That's for sure.
Yeah. The whole time I was doing the NDT stuff at Vestas and at the mill and everything, I just felt like I wasn't working like on art. I just felt like I was like, you know, you definitely lose. Like, I don't want to say like you forget how to do stuff, but like you have to develop those skills again for sure.
Yeah.
Like you have to, it's not like you're restarting, but you're definitely not where you left off for sure. Especially when you take such a long break.
Yeah.
So it's taken me a little while to like get back up to speed and to get, you know, have confidence, I guess is the best way to say it.
Yeah. I think that's a lot of it right there. Like, it's almost like a hit to your confidence in a way. And you stop doing it for a while and then you come back to it.
Yeah.
You know, it's hard to kind of get back to like where you were, or it takes a little while anyway.
Yeah. It takes a minute to like, you're like, oh yeah, okay, that's how you do this, that's how you do that. And then, you know, even though, you know, I thought about it all the time, it's just, you know, it's a different animal actually doing the stuff.
Yeah. And I think too, like it building up your endurance kind of, it's hard to, you know, just the time that you got to put in
you know, it's hard to go straight into like 8 hours of that when you're used to being like, well, I work, you know, an hour at night or something, you know, to be like, okay, this is my main thing. I got to do it all day now.
Yeah, that is, that's true.
You know, it's like trying to like run a marathon right immediately, you know.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, later you'll get used to it, but then, you know, starting off, it's kind of hard.
Especially when you're like already making money doing something else, you know what I mean? You're like, oh man, I got to try. Right. Like, oh geez, how do I switch gears to, you know, do it this way now? And, you know, especially if you like aren't.
Or go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, especially if you're not like in a, you know, if you don't have like a big sales background or, you know, it just seems like it's tough to, and it is, it's tough to sell your own, you know, like, yeah, I made this out of nothing. How much, you know, like how, you know, and then to who, how, where, and then who, and then why. And
Yeah. You get that stuff though.
Yeah. It's, you know, it's just, you know, you just got to put the time in and get over all that stuff.
I think a lot of that stuff takes care of itself when you, by trying, you know what I mean? It's like when you try a place, then you start to realize, okay, this sells here. This place doesn't sell. You know what I mean? Everybody's got an opinion about all this kind of stuff. But I think like once you kind of start trying to sell stuff here and there, you just start to realize like where stuff sells, where people are really going to buy or where they're not, things like that, you know? And I think it's different for everybody, you know? Some people can make Patreon work so well and then other people can't.
I hear you. And then on top of that too, it's like, you gotta have stuff to sell. So then you're like, okay, now I gotta have materials to create some stuff.
Yeah.
And then you gotta like, okay, well, it's gotta be good stuff or no one's gonna want it.
Right.
And then, you know, so it's just like, you know, and that's where I'm at right now is I'm just trying to build up, you know, trying to do some fan art stuff, trying to do some to get fans and then try to do some original stuff along with it.
Yeah.
So I can sell stuff, you know what I mean? So it's just, you know.
Great plan right there.
Yeah.
Great plan.
So.
Well, some sculptures have been looking really good, the ones I've seen, so.
Oh, thanks, man. When I did, I'm not going to lie, like when I was doing that Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle, I did that right before I left. I like finished it literally a couple hours before I left that morning.
Yeah.
I had messed up so many times on him, like painting him. Cause I, you know, I usually just always hire my stuff out to be painted. And I was just like, man, that is such a hassle. And then I had a little bit of a falling out with the guy and he kept a bunch of my, you know, sculpts and stuff that I sent him to get painted. And, I kind of told you about some of that like a year and a half ago or whatever, but I was just like, man. And then I learned how to do my own molding and casting. That was something I had hired out before. And then recently I was just like, man, if I could figure out how to do the painting too, that would be awesome.
Yeah.
And, so that's what kind of what I was trying to teach myself how to do. But, you know, I messed up so many times on that turtle trying to make that work and trying to use my dad's old stuff and, you know, just like not having the right tools really and then really not knowing how to, you know, opaque and transparent and how those work on top of each other. And
yeah,
just like all this new stuff you have to learn. And then like shading and then what not to shade. But anyway, it was just like this little head too. And it was frustrating like to keep messing up. And then to figure out how to use Friskit and then in what areas you even need that and what areas you don't need to, like, you don't have to paintbrush, you know, you don't have to do everything with just one tool. It's just, you know, just like anything. It takes a while to learn all that.
Yeah, definitely.
But like the end result came out pretty cool looking and I was happy with what I was able to achieve. And then the guy that I did for my mom, like that's, he's actually right here, actually. I haven't even given it to her yet. I went and saw her, but I haven't given it to her yet. I forgot it.
That's cool.
But it was just like a really...
Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, like, it was just originally supposed to be a much simpler design. But as I was working it, it just kind of took over, and then it got to this point, and I didn't even, like, you know, finish the back of the guy. You can still see the armature and, like, the foil and all this stuff.
Oh, cool, yeah.
And it was just supposed to be seen from, like, a few angles anyway, so I didn't really mind, but, like, airbrushing this and, like, getting confidence, like, you know, how to get the grays and, you know, how to get all these different colors and shades, like, with his eyeballs, like, with the yellow and the orange and the red and all that. You know, and then I didn't mess up at all on this, and I was really proud of that. I was like, wow, I didn't have to repaint anything on that guy.
Yeah.
And he still looks pretty good. So I was just like, man, that's, you know, it gives me hope. And now, like, not hope, but it gives me, like, excitement because, like, it's, like, you know, something else I get to figure out and mess with. And, you know, I get to control the colors and all these things.
Yeah.
And then, you know, and if it messes up, then, you know, that's based on nothing. I just made that out of my mind. And then, so then I had to come up with all the colors out of my mind.
Yeah.
And then, which was fun. It was actually quite a bit of fun. And then, like, I'm thinking of sculpting now in terms of painting it later, which actually helps me out quite a bit.
Yeah.
So when I did those Dragon's Lair's heads, or the Dirk heads.
Yeah.
I painted all those, and it just was killing me because it was so time consuming. And then the sculpt was good, but I didn't really like think about the painting stage at all. And I could have saved myself a bunch of pitfalls had I thought about that just a little bit more as I was working on it.
Yeah. Well, it makes sense. You know, once you kind of know how to paint, then you kind of know, like, you know, what kind of textures and stuff you can put to make it easier and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
It just makes sense to me, like, you paint your own stuff, you know? Like, I remember when you used to, like, you know, hire it out and everything like that, and I always thought, wow, you know, just, like, such a rigmarole to go through. And I don't know. It just makes sense to me if you can do it yourself, you know?
Yeah.
Just one less guy to pay, you know what I mean?
Yeah, and then there's, like, the whole shipping thing, and then... You know,
yeah.
It was just a hassle. I mean, the whole way around it, and then, like, you know, who knows when you'll get it back? Who knows when he'll be done?
Totally.
And there's always, like, you know, he's got his own problems in his own life, and, you know, there's always delays.
Yeah.
But you know, it's fun. It's cool to, like, take a break from sculpting and go to that too. You know what I mean?
Right.
Because it, you know. Definitely, it is nice to have, like, a little bit of a break.
And plus, I think just to be able to go to all that, just, like, the completely finished piece, that's got to be satisfying, too.
Yeah, it is. You know? It really is.
Yeah.
To say I did 100% of this whole thing and then, you know, paint. And then also I can paint everything, and that saves on, like, Patreon costs or, like, selling costs, you know what I mean? Because I don't have to factor in shipping it to someone else and then paying them to paint it. Or, you know, whatever, and then shipping it to whoever and hoping he gets the address right to the other person and all these things, which it didn't always happen. And, you know, sometimes things would get lost in the mail, you know, which can happen anyway, but you're, like, reducing the risk of it if it's just one-to-one, you know what I mean?
Yeah. So that sculpt and, like, that Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle head and stuff, is that stuff, like... Is that still is it like the Sculpey sculpt, or is that like a mold that you cast off it, or like the one that you're actually painting?
Yeah, they're all the original piece. Yeah, it's the original. It's not a cast or anything.
Okay.
Which is, you know, when I did that head from Paranorman, you know, I was trying a bunch of different, you know, everything I've been trying for the last while has been, like, little tests. Like, I'll have a question, and then I'll be like, okay, well, how could I do that? And then I'll think of a character that would fit. And then I'll do it, and sometimes I won't, like, finish the thing. And, like, once I get to the answer of the question, I won't, you know, I won't keep going. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I had a big problem with that for years. Everything was an experiment. Nothing was ever finished work, you know?
Yeah, that's where I'm at right now. Is I'm like, I got to quit doing so many of these experiments and just get to finish work. Even if it's not perfect, if it's at least finished, then that's good enough.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's funny. I mean, a lot of what got me out of that, you know, beyond just like when I worked for different people, was when I actually started doing sketch cards, because, you know, you need to sell finished stuff, and, you know, you got to have finished stuff, so you got to finish everything. And it finally kind of broke me out of that, because I was bad with that till I was like, you know, almost in my 40s, you know. I don't know. It can just be a problem if you let it be, I think, you know. If you can just use it for how it's supposed to be.
It is.
You know, that's fine.
It is like a great, like, exercise, you know what I mean? But to not finish mm-hmm. is the main pitfall there, I think.
Yeah, because you miss out on that last thing, which is to get some money off it, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, ultimately, if that's your goal, you know, you should probably finish stuff.
Right.
Which is, sounds easy or simple, but it's like when you're in the middle of it, like, you lose the inspiration. Like, okay, I'm done with it now. I got the answer to the question.
Right. Yeah.
No need to, you know, why would I want to keep working on this when I can go work on something I want to work on?
Exactly.
Which, or just the answer to another question is all you're really moving to.
Yeah. I know. 'Cause that's the thing, is like, you're in this constant learning stage. So it's kind of really hard to ever, you know what I mean, answer the final question, I guess, and then be like, okay, now I can work. It just never gets to that, you know. But I was thinking too, like, with the, you know, why I asked about that, if you're painting the originals or like the ones that you're pulling or whatever, because like I've seen different, like, mainly it's been like girls, but where they do kind of like these one-off, well, actually there's a lot of sculptors too, but I mean, the main ones I saw was some of these people on places like eBay and Etsy, where they're doing kind of these one-off dolls or sculpts and things like that. And they would be, you know, sculpty and whatever fabric and all that kind of stuff. But a lot of them would, you know, go for quite a bit of money on there.
Yeah. I was actually noticing that, a couple weeks ago myself, and
yeah,
I'm kind of working that into the whole, you know, not doing so much, you know, if I do have a question and I do need to work it out in clay, then do it and then finish it and then sell it. And, you know, and kind of a similar, you know, thing, like throw it up on eBay as a one-off and then not have to pay for, you know, the materials to make molds and casts and, like, you know what I mean? 'Cause it's like, just because you do all that doesn't mean it's going to sell anyway.
Right.
And, you know, especially if it's like a copyrighted thing anyway, and it, you know, there's always that whole pile of crap. So, but like, if it's a one-off, if it's
doing a few,
what's that?
So I think you'd probably be pretty safe just doing a few.
Yeah, I mean, that's true. And like, I did all those dirt heads, and I had this whole plan of selling those or giving them away. And but then I was just like, man, it'd be cool to like go to a convention, and like, I think that'd be a really cool place to
absolutely
to have some of those like available.
I mean, I think I told you about that one con I went to, and I mean, you know, there's like a lot of people selling lots of stuff, but there was this girl selling little toy looking things. You know, they were little sculpts, but not like gear sculpts. They were just completely different, but they were just these cute little sculpts. And I mean, man, her table was just like, I don't think it was ever empty, like the whole time I was there. And then like the kids around that table were just like crazy, you know. People just seem to be like clamoring for that stuff, you know.
Yeah. And, you know, and then those ladies that we kind of met on Twitch, like we were watching, they were doing like similar little things that they were selling on Etsy. And,
oh, I forgot about that. Yeah.
Like, and there's that one girl who's doing the, man, I can't remember what her name was, but she was doing like those little tiny sculptures that she like sculpted on, keyboard keys.
Oh, right. Yeah. I forgot about that.
like, you know, like, you know, Buzz Lightyear or Woody or whatever, and then sewn like the one-offs. Yeah. You know, and she's making a, you know, she had a, you know, pretty good sized following, I would say. I mean, I don't know, you know, it's not like, you know, Taylor Swift or something, but it's, you know, she's got like a huge, she's got like a pretty good, you know, pretty decent, you know, at least a living. You definitely can make a living.
Right.
And, you know, and that's something I got to, you know, start doing. And that's something I am trying to do. And like also tutorials, I'm actually doing a tutorial right now. I'm trying to like shoot as I do something, as I sculpt something, and then at the end of it, have the one-off and then sell it. And then also the video can hopefully bring me more followers and patrons and stuff. And then,
yeah,
you know, that's not, idea. That's not a lot of extra work. And if anything, it should pay off more in the end, I would say, hopefully.
Yeah, totally.
So that's kind of what I'm working on right now.
Yeah.
And then also trying to figure out a way to do prints and t-shirt designs is, that's another thing I want to figure out. Cause I can't, you know, the one thing that sucks about sculpting, at least I thought before, is, you know, I can't really, you know, short of giving somebody, I can't really do digital work, I guess is what I'm saying, but I can, that's what I thought before anyway, was, you know, I would always have to like make something and then ship it to someone's house. And lots of people don't want that. And especially at the prices that costs, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I'm trying to find ways to get cool stuff to people without having to actually make a bunch of sculpts unless they really want it, or, you know.
Sure.
Do some prints and some tutorials, you know, start trying to develop digital content.
You mean like a print of your sculpture?
Yeah, like a really cool looking, like, you know, a professionally, yeah, like a professional photograph, you know.
And that's kind of neat. Yeah, that's a neat idea.
And then doing prints like that, like signed, you know, not like maybe not signed, but like personalized and signed or whatever. And then,
yeah, definitely signed.
And then cheap. I mean, that would be, you know, like a buck tops, I'm assuming, to like ship it all and everything in a little envelope. And then
print?
Yeah. Or like, you know, not like a huge one like yours, like yeah, you know, something that would fit like one of your littler ones, or I guess they could pick the size. Eight, I don't
know. 10 or something.
Yeah, I'm assuming that's got to be, you know, pretty cheap. And then digital content in terms of like tutorials, or like not to say like this is the way to do it, but like to say here's the way I did it, you know what I mean? And then see if people want to follow along with that. And then like t-shirt designs, I think that'd be kind of cool to have like a, you know, a badass like sculpture on the t-shirt. And then, you know, that'd be kind of cool to have some, because I actually know a guy who I used to work with at Vestas. He's doing his own clothing line thing. And so I got to talking with him and thinking myself, and I was like, wow, that'd be kind of cool. Because, like, you know, he doesn't, it just, a lot of the t-shirts and stuff, they you can definitely get some cool art on them, but it would be neat. Yeah. Like, I haven't seen very many t-shirts where it's been like a sculpture on it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. It's a unique idea. And I almost think like maybe it could work, you know, the right kind of thing. There's like a illustrator, man, I'll never remember his name like right now without trying to search him, but he does like, you know, all his illustration is just, like sculpture, well sculpted people, and you know what I mean?
Like
puppets, like animation, but it's not moving. He just takes a picture of it, and then like that picture is like in the animation in the magazine. Sorry. I don't know if he's even famous enough for you to like know it. You know what I mean? Like you're gonna guess, but that's kind of the same thing though. You know what I mean? Whoever he makes everything, they takes a picture of it. Like that's his art. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And like, you know, he does that same thing where he like sets up little scenes, and you know, they're usually like these, they're kind of creepy looking people. You know, they like have these little round heads with these funny looking eyeballs and stuff. And I don't know, but it has that look, you know, it's almost like that Tim Burton look, but not really that, where, you know, it has that look where people would dig it, I would think. So
sounds unique for sure.
I'll try to find a link, maybe try to show it to you later.
Yeah, I'm definitely interested in seeing that.
Yeah. But I could totally see like his stuff on t-shirts and yeah, I mean, why not you too, man? That's pretty neat.
And it's a cool way to like maybe get some support of someone that like maybe only has like, you know, because I've tried doing the small figurine thing and that works to a certain extent, but it's just like so tough to, you know what I mean? I'm sure it would kill at like a convention or something, but like to try and find an internet,
you know,
like an audience for that right now on the internet is just like, it's not really happening. So, or at least not at the pace I want it to. So I want to try and develop some other ways and, you know, I definitely not get rid of that idea, but try to find some other stuff that'll work in the short term.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I've definitely saw that in like my own business where, like original art, like there's some people who can't get enough of it and there's some people who just don't ever want it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then there's like this whole other range of customers that, you know, are like all over the place in between and stuff. And, it's just, I don't know, like you said, you know, it's like, I mean, like with my own business, you know, like I have certain people who buy prints and then like never buy originals. And then like other people who, you know, they're only original, they don't care about prints. And just that's just how it is, you know?
Yeah.
So to try to figure out like some stuff that to sell to everybody is, I think it's a great idea.
Well, and I think also too, like offering, I hate to say tutorials, but not just the way I'm doing things and seeing if people want to follow along like that. You know, cause there's a million ways to do everything, obviously. But I guess it would be considered a tutorial regardless. But I mean, it's just to like, as a way to try and get, you know, people more engaged for longer. You know what I mean? Cause it doesn't take long to just look at a quick sculpture and then move on. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But if you have like some video content and stuff like that, that people could be like, oh, okay, this is how he did that. All right. And maybe, you know, and then maybe start generating some ad money as well. And just try to get more traffic and more eyeballs, you know?
I think that's a great idea. I mean, it's kind of like, you know, like there's these two artists like the Jeff Marincola and James Gurney. And, you know, it's like both of them, you know, it's kind of, I mean, it's not 100% their business model, but it's sort of what they're doing with YouTube, especially like James Gurney, you know, he just does short videos on YouTube and then has a link to, you know, download the long video of me painting this, you know, dinosaur painting. And I don't know how he's doing with it, but I imagine pretty well.
Is that the guy that does those little like stop motions with like the puppet flying around? He's like flips a bunch. I don't remember what his name is, but he does lots of flips and stuff like that.
Yeah, and he does like the replacement animation.
Yeah, it's all replacement, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, that's him.
That's cool. Yeah, actually, I've seen a couple of his videos. Like, I didn't know he painted, but but that's cool. He does. I definitely have seen his stop motions, and then he has like these cool like title effects, like practical title effects, which I think are really cool.
Yeah, it's funny because he's actually like a really famous artist. You know, he did this book called Dinotopia, and so he's like,
huge. I remember that TV show.
Well, there you go. That's him.
Really, that guy made a. He wrote the book and they made a TV show of it?
Yeah, there's like several books that he wrote and they're really cool. They're like heavily illustrated, you know.
Wow.
And then, you know, they made the TV show from it. I don't know if he had that much to do with it or whatever, but yeah. So, you know, he's like really, if people know him, it's because of his art. Yeah.
Wow, that's cool. Yeah, I had no idea. I just thought he was like a YouTube
stop motion guy.
Which is also, that's another thing I want to definitely get into also is stop motion. I definitely feel
there's definitely people wanting those videos for stop motion. Cause I mean, those videos are probably my most popular videos, you know, even though I don't have that many of them.
Yeah.
Like the ones where I was making my stuff and everything, those get more views and more questions and more everything, than really anything I've done on YouTube, really. But it's hard to, you know, like, there's another one. It's like, how do you make money off that stuff so you can do it all the time? You know, it's really hard to figure out.
Yeah. But, I mean, do you find, like, you get a pretty good, like, audience coming back and, like, supporting you with your other stuff? Or are they just there for stop motion? Or
it seems like the stop motion guys, I mean, there's definitely crossover, but they're, you know, it's like they were here for the stop motion stuff and then, like, you know, you never see them again. So I think they're into stop motion. And, you know, once you stop doing it, they don't stick around for the art videos.
Yeah.
You know, it's a different thing, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, you know, not everyone's going to be into rock and roll and country.
That's right. What was I looking at the other day? I can't remember. I mean, there's so much stuff on YouTube that's like that, though. Like, you know, I mean, you know, like the stuff I talk about. It's like I watch so much other stuff that's like, you know, like I watch this guy who's like a blacksmith. Like, I've been like lately, I've been watching. It's like an art cast, but it's like he's blacksmithing. You know what I mean? So he's like in there hammering and just talking to the camera and stuff.
Oh, well, that's cool.
And he makes like knives and stuff. Yeah. And then, you know, it's just like there's every sort of niche is on YouTube. And I don't know. It always surprises me, like, what's the next thing you can find? And then it also surprises me, like, how close something will be to, like, what I do. And then, like, I'll find it and I'll be like, man, I had no idea that they were here. And it's just weird that, like, YouTube never put it together in all this time to sort of, like, serve me up their videos in my sidebar, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I'm trying to think of like what I just started watching and it was just like that where I'm like, damn, this is almost like what I do, but I've never seen this before.
Oh man, that's cool. Like you mean in terms of stop motion or with the illustration?
Well, art or stop motion or whatever, you know.
Yeah. I know there's a guy I've been following for a while. I think his name is Will. But he does like a lot of cool, like, little projects and stuff like that. And then he also does like some stop motion and some sculpting tutorials. And, he seems like he's got a pretty large following and he does like these giveaways and stuff. But he does that guy's doing everything, man. He's like making beer and he's like making stop motions and he's like blacksmithing. Cool. He's like blacksmithing. He's,
yeah.
Like all these dioramas or dioramas or however the hell you say that.
I know. Yeah. And I think I found that guy from the stop motion too. And it's like Epic Fantasy or something. Isn't that what he calls his channel?
Oh yeah. Storm the Castle. But
Storm the Castle, yeah.
But Epic Fantasy. Oh yeah. That's his name on there.
Right.
But his channel is called Storm the Castle. And then his name is Will, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, because he always says that. Hey, this is Will from Storm the Castle.
Yeah, that's right. Hey, what's up, Will? And he's like, he just seems like a cool fella to hang out with for a little while.
I know. Yeah, he used to put out a ton of videos. Like I've subscribed to him, but I don't know. Maybe you know, YouTube did something where I'm not getting the emails anymore. But it's like I haven't seen as much from him as I used to see. You know.
Yeah, he used to like have almost daily, I think. Like when I first found him, he was doing these little tiny, really small little sculptures for like dioramas. And then, and then he was doing stop motion for a while. And then he took a break and I was like, oh, okay. I understand. Yeah. I understand you, my boy.
I know.
And then he came back and he was just like doing, like, you know, he's like making, you know, like styrofoam swords and like he was doing this, he's like learning how to make beer or meat, some sort of alcohol. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah. Maybe meat. Yeah, I don't remember that one, but yeah. Did you see the ones where he made that giant like styrofoam dragon or whatever?
I seen where he made the gun to kill the dragon.
Yeah.
But I don't remember him making the actual dragon. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
And then, like, he has this neat little intro. It used to be all stop motion, but now he's got, like, a little bit of everything.
Yeah.
But he did, like, this little stop motion intro to his channel, which was pretty neat.
That's cool. Yeah, I haven't. Whenever I came along, I think I had already missed the stop motion because I kind of, you know, I'm sure I found it searching stop motion, trying to figure stuff out, you know, on the web, like all of us are. And then, you know, like he wasn't doing it anymore by the time I came across him.
Yeah.
But definitely pretty cool. And then, like, you know, like, I don't know, the ones he was doing a lot when I was really watching him was a lot of those, you know, like you said, the styrofoam swords and, you know, showing kids how to make swords out of cardboard and stuff, which is pretty cool.
Yeah.
I mean, sometimes, like, when I'm doing stuff with my son, I almost feel like, man, I should be getting the video camera out and filming it because it seems like we're always doing stuff like that. He's like really into like Minecraft now, and so we've been, you know, he's always wanting like, I'm gonna make a crafting table, and I'll be like, you know, okay, I'll go get your cardboard box, and then, you know, inevitably I'm in there with him, freaking painting it up and stuff, you know.
Yeah.
But it's just, you know, I don't know. We made him like this foam Minecraft sword at one point, and I don't know, lots of stuff. You gotta have kids, dude, so you can do all this fun stuff for your kids.
Yeah, no, I want to make like some videos like you made, where like he's, you know, flying off like Iron Man, and like, that stuff's badass.
I know. I need to make more of that kind of stuff. I don't know. I finally got my camera working again. That lower camera wasn't working that well, and that's like the one I kind of film that kind of stuff with.
Yeah.
And now it's back to peak performance, so I just gotta do it though.
The one with like the really short battery span or whatever.
Yeah, that one. That one was sucking hard there for a while. Try to record a video in like 30 seconds, blah, 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 before it kicks back off. You turn it back on. Do it again.
I had to switch the battery out.
Yeah. Well, this one, I got my new webcam. I mean, that just goes on my computer, but my other one, you know, I used to have a thing where I could plug it in, and I got that for stop motion, and that worked awesome because it would just stay on all the time. But it's funny, that thing burned out. It stopped working, so now I'm back to switching batteries on the other one, too.
So, the one that you could leave plug in, it burned out?
Well, not the camera, but the cord plug-in thing.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that thing burned out.
Oh.
So I guess everybody was right about the cheap Chinese ones, but... Like, the real ones were, like, $70 or something. I didn't want to spend that, jeez. So. Yeah, so I'll probably just buy another $15 one off of eBay. See how long it lasts.
At least it lasted for a while.
Yeah, you know, I made it through my whole, you know, little movie and stuff, so.
Has he, I know he was kind of involved with the, you know, getting the set built and all that stuff. Does he ever, like, want to go back out there and animate, or?
He, you know, it's funny. He did actually help me animate like a couple scenes. There was like a couple times where I drug him out there. This is so funny because it's like, you know, he was like quite a bit younger already because this has already been like a year ago or something now, or maybe even 2 years ago. And well, that was probably about a year. And so like I was shooting one where the guard was, you know, sneaking up to the guy standing around the corner.
Yeah.
And I couldn't reach the like, tie downs, you know, I was like, because it was pretty far across the set. So I couldn't get both hands, like hold the puppet with one hand and then do the tie down with the other hand.
Yeah.
So each time I'd move the foot forward, I couldn't catch it because, you know, I couldn't catch it with one hand just sticking the screw up underneath the floor. So I go get Tristan and drag him out there. And I'm like, okay, don't touch anything. Don't bump the camera. Don't, you know what I mean? Yeah. And I'm like, I just want you to hold his foot down. I'm going to like work this screw. Up into a split.
Wow.
It's so like it works pretty good the first time, but it's just hard because like while you're animating, he's wanting to play and he's jiggling stuff, and you know what I mean.
Yeah.
And so I get to like the, you know, a couple steps in, and I'm underneath there, and I'm like, "Where is his foot? Are you holding it?" And he's like, "Oh, yes." And I'm like, "It's not on there. Are you holding it?" And he's like, yes. And I like stick my head back up over the board, and he's like holding the foot down, and the whole puppet is like laying down on the set, like on its back. You know? You know, you can't yell at him because you're just like, well, I guess I didn't tell him to hold the puppet too, you know?
Yeah. Which is definitely a nightmare for stop motion.
Right. It was just funny.
Worst case scenario.
There's actually scenes in there that really helped me animate.
Did you have to reshoot that that part there, or were you able to get it back?
I think I can't remember. There was a couple of those walks where I reshot. That might have been one of them. But I went ahead and I just put him back and, you know, tried to get him lined up with the frame grabber.
Yeah.
And then, you know, just went on with it. But I don't know. There was a couple of those walks where I was just like, I gotta fix it, you know.
Yeah, I remember you showed me I think you showed me one of your one of the ones that didn't make it. And I was like, doesn't look too bad. And it's funny, I remember you showing me
that's funny coming from you because you're like so critical, like of your own work and like stop motion. Like I remember like the stuff you showed me and I'd be like, nothing wrong with it, it's done. You're like, no, this isn't right, this isn't right. Yeah.
And I remember you telling me
like my finished stuff wasn't as good as like that stuff. So
it's funny you were telling me about the like when you like you had those dead pixels or whatever, and you were trying to like erase them. Like I never noticed any of those, and then once you told me about that, I was like watching all these other videos and stuff, and I was like, holy cow, there's like these things are everywhere. Like even in in professional like movies, like I noticed them a bunch in Fantastic Mr. Fox.
Oh, really?
And like, you know, you can even see a bunch of dead pixels in like Pirates, like, you know, Band of Misfits and stuff like that. I was like, man, and then I never really noticed. And like, even on like YouTube, you know, of course you could see them like in other videos and stuff, but you know, it's just like another something like, if you wouldn't have brought that up to me, I'd have never seen them. And then like, once you told me about them in yours, I was like, I could see them in yours, you know, ones that you didn't point out. And I was like, man, I wish you would have just never told me about those. Because now I like find myself like, oh, if you guys look right here, there's going to be a dead pixel.
Right.
Did you see it? I'm like, oh, no, I didn't see it.
Yeah. Well, they're not real noticeable, but I don't know. When you're staring at the footage and just over and over, especially like stop motion, because you just
obsess over every little thing.
Yeah, and then you start to see them. And when I started to see them, then I was like, oh, my God, they're, like, fucking everywhere. It's like my movie has smallpox. And, that was a challenge. But it's a good way to get rid of them. That video I made about getting rid of them, it's like that really does work really well. So
Have you been getting a lot of feedback from people, like, saying, oh, wow, this has worked great?
I had a few people actually, kind of contact me about that. I think the thing with like stop motion is you get a lot more people talking about how to make hands and stuff, because I think, you know, like it's almost like comics where there's just, you know, the amount of people that actually get to the finished movie and start putting it together are like super small compared to like the people who start one, you know, start making a puppet or something. So I mean, I got to hand it to anybody who gets to the end. And I mean, you know, I got to the end of my one little short episode. I didn't get to the end of my whole thing. So,
well, yeah.
Anybody can get to the end of their whole thing is like awesome.
Anyone who can like even start something like that and like get some stuff shot, it's just like, so that's so impressive. Cause I mean, it's such an undertaking. Like, I don't think a lot of people even like, they see like animations and stuff and they really don't. You know, at least people that I talk to, they just like have no clue about what goes into, you know, the work and everything like that comes, you know, just like every time you blink, you're missing like, you know, days of work.
Right. Well, I, you know, like I knew about animation to an extent, but it's like, I even was just totally had no clue like what I was getting into when I started that thing, you know, just the learning curve of all the stuff you got to learn and, you know. It sounds easy, you know, move it a little bit and take a picture, move it a little bit, take a picture. It's like a lot more to it, man.
Yeah, no one really talks about, you know, the timing of the how many frames are in a second, and, you know, the math, how to get the thing to talk. I mean, it's just like so much.
Right.
It's like, so much fun too.
Yeah.
I really wish they would have been teaching that in like school growing up.
Yeah,
totally. Like if you could have just went to like a room for like an hour a week or whatever and just like messed around with that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Instead of dissecting frogs.
Yeah, who the hell needs that? Get rid of algebra. Let's do some stop motion, everybody.
Yeah. Something we're going to use later.
You got just as much a chance of using this stuff as you do, you know. Whatever geometry or something. I don't know.
So have you, I was watching this this documentary the other day when I was working out. And do you know like the whole like Batman story about like the, the guy who came up with Batman and all this stuff? Like, I didn't know there was such a controversy about this, but.
You mean like Bob Kane or whatever?
Yeah, Bob Kane.
I mean, I kind of, you know, I know some of it, like, but I don't know if like I'm going to know what you're going to tell me, because I didn't know there was like that big of a controversy. I mean, like, because of like DC had it for so long and wouldn't give it back to him.
No, not that. Okay. There's this guy, his name was like, I think it wasn't Goldfinger. His name was just Finger. That's what it was. It was, there's Bob Kane. And I think the guy's
Bob
name
Finger.
Was it Bob Finger? They're both Bob.
Wait a minute. Maybe I'm wrong.
Bob. One was Bob Kane and one was like Dave Finger or something like that. Or Rob Finger. Was it Rob? Ah, oh, crap. I can't remember. It's been like a week and a half, but I think I know the guy's last. I know the guy's last name was like Finger. Do you like to know that whole story?
One of the artists, but no, go ahead with what you're going to tell me.
Well, yeah,
one of, like Bob, the later artists.
Well, I guess no, he was right there from the very beginning.
Okay.
I guess Bob Kane had, you know, he had seen how well that the Superman guys are doing with theirs. It was before they sold it.
Oh, and, Bill Finger was his name.
Oh yeah, Bill Finger. Oh yeah,
there we go.
Bob and Bill. What did I say? Rob or something?
Yeah, Joel. No, anyway. Go ahead.
Consuelo Finger.
But I thought that Bob Kane did draw Batman in the beginning. I didn't realize that he was that far back.
No, that guy's like a douchebag, man.
Bob Kane?
Yeah, like after that whole thing, I just came away thinking, man, that guy is such a low-life dirtbag.
Oh my God, okay. Well, let me hear the whole story, then.
Well, the thing is, it's like, it's this thing on Hulu. It's called Batman and Bill. Yeah, I can't believe I didn't. Okay. but the, like, Bill Finger was there at the very beginning. And, well, anyway, the guy, Bob Kane had seen how well the Superman guys were doing. And it was before they had sold off Superman for, like, $20 or whatever they did.
Yeah.
And they were making a lot of money, you know, doing their comic, and you know, it was coming out every month or whatever. And he told, like, Bob Kane told, like, his the guys he worked with, who eventually became DC, he told him, like, he's going to go home and he's going to come up with a superhero over the weekend, and he'll come back on Monday. And
oh, man. That's crazy.
He'll have a whole design for him. And they're like, all right, whatever. And so he went, and he did go, and he did draw, and he did come up with a concept of a character, but then he brought in Bill Finger, which was his buddy, and they were buddies, and they had worked together on comics at that place, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And he was like a ghost artist, that Bill Finger guy, and he worked with Bob, and they came up with a design, and Bob showed Bill, this is going to get confusing for me.
Yeah.
Bob showed Bill, like, he showed him what he had drawn so far, and he was like, oh man, this isn't going to work. He's like, because he didn't have a cowl on the guy. He just had like a Robin mask. He looked more like Robin. He was like red and black. And he was like, let's make him like a dark knight. And then he put the cowl on him with the ears. He's like, let's make him a bat. Like, he's scared of bats, or, you know, and they can't, he, basically developed the whole thing with him. And then he put the logo on his chest. It was his idea for that, and like he came up with the entire Batman world. And there's like, you know, and then
yeah, Joker, all great,
yeah, characters. The Batcave, naming Batman, Gotham City, the Batmobile, Commissioner Gordon, Joker, all these things. He did all of that. It was all Bill Finger. And so Bob Kane went in the next day. Well, I mean, they didn't come up with all that weekend, but he came up with the initial concept and the character and everything.
Yeah.
And Bob Kane went in there on Monday and pitched Batman. And then they're like, all right, this sounds good. When can you start making the first issues? And they're like, all right, well, immediately. And he was like, all right, well, then they wrote the contract, and he said that he did it all by himself. And he was the sole owner and creator. And anytime Batman appears anywhere, it has to have Bob Kane's name on it.
Yeah.
And he was the sole creator is how he worded it. So he's the sole creator of Batman. And basically, I mean, Batman goes on to become a huge success, right?
Right.
And this, like the Bill Finger guy, he's like, he's struggling to make ends meet. He's like dying. Yeah. He's got these like, he's got like these diseases, and he's dying, and he was still worked in comics for a little while, but he couldn't get work doing anything really.
Yeah.
And then like the guy who was like doing this book, he was writing a book on all this. It's kind of a deeper story, but anyway, at the end of it, like it just turns out that the dude had even admitted lying when he wrote his own book, that Bob or that Bill Finger had, you know, contributed a great deal and most of everything to Batman. And he said, and then of course, Bill Finger died, you know, alone in an apartment trying to make ends meet.
Yeah.
And then he didn't even have any family or whatever. And, they said that he got buried in a potter's grave, which is like, you know, where no one, like we're homeless people and like people with no family or anything, when they die, they get buried in like this big, I guess it's like a big communal type of grave type deal. Or it's just like a bunch of little ones. I mean, I'm not really for sure, but they did find out that, you know, he did have a son. It was like all these, this guy who wrote this book and did the documentary went through tons and tons of crap. And then like, you know, then he the only way you can get those contracts reversed and then all that is to, you have to have an heir, which he actually did find one. And then he found, you know, that she was still alive and he tracked her down. And, I mean, it was just a really cool story. I mean, it sucks because Bob Kane was such a douchebag to his friend.
Yeah.
Totally. I mean, he was just showboating about it too. You know, about how, you know, how popular he was and that he created Batman, and he would like even, you know, do these oil paintings that he didn't even really do and sell them for a bunch of money and of Batman.
Oh, really?
Just all kinds of just like shady crap, man.
That is crazy. I didn't know any of that. That is wild, man. I'm going to have to track this down and watch it. I had no idea about any of that stuff.
Yeah. I couldn't believe it. And then like, whenever you know, you're talking to people and you ask them about who created Batman, I mean, everyone knows Bob Kane.
Yeah, totally. That is crazy. That is wild stuff, man. I totally got to find this thing.
The only Batman credit that Bill Finger ever got was he was able to write an episode of the original TV series.
Yeah.
And it was like the one where they were like on the big typewriter, I think.
Yeah.
Something like that. And then like, or no, it was with the clocks, something with the clocks. And, that was the only Batman credit he ever got, even though he did pretty much all the Batman stories of the comics. And
well, that's wild. I mean, I did know his name. I mean, he must've been credited as an artist.
Well, eventually he was able to fight, and the family, they could never get DC to reverse their role.
Yeah.
Because they were like, well, this contract has been in place for, you know, forever, and we can't really go back on it. And because the family just wanted to get his name on, you know, on the Batman movies, but then DC finally came around and they tried to get her to just sign it and shut up, but she didn't do it. And then eventually they did, like on the new Batman movies with Ben Affleck, like it's Bill Finger and, you
no
know,
kidding.
Yeah,
that's wild. That's super cool though.
Yeah, it is cool that they finally got it reversed, and it makes you think. It's like, it's just, you know, people always are like fighting over credit and who did what and created this and created that. That was a pretty cool, it's very important.
Mm-hmm.
Because like his family knew the entire time that he had created Batman, but no one would ever believe him, you know?
Right.
And then before Bob Kane died, he started revealing that he's like, yeah, I really wish I would have, you know, I wish I would have done more for Bill. And he did do a majority of the creation of Batman. And like, they had these old audio files where he was telling this guy who was writing his book, he was telling all the stuff to him.
Wow.
It's definitely a cool story, but he didn't end up being buried in a potter's grave. His son actually came and got him, but it was the day after, which is why I wasn't on the death certificate. And, he went and he took his dad's ashes and he put them in the beach, and he drew out like a bat symbol and then put the ashes inside of it.
Mm.
And then the water took it away. Which I thought that was pretty neat, man.
That is
sad,
cool.
Sad as hell. But like, I mean, the dude had a,
it's interesting. Yeah. Cause I mean, you hear about like so many of these guys, like, you know, the Superman guys and Jack Kirby and stuff, and it's always like the artists that are the victims, you know what I mean? They sign away their creations, and I always thought that Bob Kane was kind of the same situation, because I thought that it was sort of like the same deal with Superman, but I think that I thought that they came around, you know, and made some kind of deal with him later on.
You mean with the Superman guys? They talked about them in the documentary.
I know they didn't with the Superman guys, but I mean, I thought with the Bob Kane they did, because, like, you know, when the, you know, like the Batman movies were so popular, like in the 80s, I guess, like when Michael Keaton.
Yeah.
You know, I guess, like, I think that was sort of like when.
Well,
when that all happened, if I'm not mistaken, but.
Well, Bob Kane was, he was around from the start. Like, he had never lost anything or whatever. Like, when the Keaton movies were out, they showed footage of him like coming out of the limo with this big fur coat, and he was like, yeah, you know, he was playing up to the crowd.
Because I don't think that's right, is it? I mean, like, because I thought all those guys lost all their stuff back then, and I thought Bob Kane was one of them.
No, from what I saw in that thing, like all the timeline of Bob Kane, ever since that time he came up with Batman, he had been banking.
Hmm.
And like, when, like on every story, like on every issue and everything that was around, it always said Bob Kane in that square, you know what I mean? His initials or his signature or whatever.
Right.
On every comic, on every painting or whatever. And then on all the movies, like the Keaton movies and everything, you know, it said at the beginning, cause they showed it, you know, and, you know, I didn't really pay attention when I first seen it or whatever, but they showed like the opening credits, and they showed like his name. Batman is created by Bob Kane.
Well, I know by then, because it, like, by then, like, there a lot of like the bad press had like came out, you know, about everybody, and so it just, you know, by then it wasn't, you know, the same thing as like back in the day.
So you're saying that Batman, or that like the artists all, well, not all, but like you're saying a majority of them lost, like,
Well, like Jack Kirby, for example, like, you know, he created, you know, Captain America and all these other guys, Fantastic Four and all that. And then, you know, I mean, he basically didn't have any rights to them once, you know, whatever that company was called before Marvel was Marvel, you know what I mean, took all the rights to it. And Jack Kirby pretty much got nothing. And I think that was like pretty much everybody, you know, or that's at least how I... you know, remember reading about it, but maybe I'm right. I know, like, the Superman guys basically signed over Superman, and, you know, it was, like, that's, like, kind of a famous story, because I think one of them was working at, like, the post office or something when the Superman movies were coming out.
Yeah, he was, like, making nothing.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, I don't know, man. It definitely seemed like Bob Kane was making tons of money the entire time. So I don't know if, like, there was a point in time. I didn't even know Jack Kirby, like, I thought that was all, like, because I thought him and Stan Lee started Marvel, and then, like they were the owners or whatever.
No, Stan Lee was, you know, editor-in-chief or whatever, I guess. And then, you know, Jack Kirby, I mean, but they definitely weren't the owners.
Oh, really?
But so, even, like, Stan Lee is not, you know, like, Stan Lee's always sort of stayed with Marvel. I mean, like, Jack Kirby left Marvel, like, in the 60s, I guess, or maybe 70s, pissed off, and went to, like, wherever he did New Gods and all that stuff, and it never really panned out for him anywhere else, you know what I mean?
Oh, geez,
that's why a lot of people were always, like, pissed about Jack Kirby. But then there was other creators, too, that just wouldn't do the same kind of stuff. I mean, everybody really that's ever worked for Marvel, you know, it's like Swamp Thing. It's, you know, those guys don't own Swamp Thing. They created that, you know. Like Bernie Wrightson and I don't know who's the other guy, Len Wein or something like that. But
I don't know. I only know of that from the TV show that terrified me as a kid.
I love the Swamp Thing, but
I don't know, man. That's so Jack Kirby, like, so he didn't make a lot of money basically from all that work he did.
Just the page rate. I mean, like, I know that, like, and I thought that this happened with Bob Kane. I thought that it was like the same deal with, like, Bob Kane, and basically, like, you know, all of them signed over their creations and were just, like, working for their page rate back then. And then I thought that, like, you know, after sort of, like, Superman came out and, like, the bad press about, like, the creators of Superman and all that kind of stuff, I thought that DC went back and, you know, made, like, royalty deals with, like, the original creators of, like, Superman and Batman and stuff like that. And that's why I thought that Bob Kane had actually came out all right, because I do remember when the Batman movies were coming out with, like, Michael Keaton and stuff. And it was, like, you know, by then it was, you know, they were talking about it. I remember, like, reading the Comics Journal and stuff about how, you know, Bob Kane was, like, okay. And it wasn't, like, the same situation as, like, this, the Superman guys, you know? So that's kind of, like, why I guess I thought that, you know, Bob Kane had, like, you know, lost his creation too at some point. But I mean, I might just completely be wrong, 'cause I don't know that, you know, I've ever, paid that much attention to it, you know?
Yeah. I don't know. The impression that I got was he was banking the entire time. There was never a point in time where he wasn't even doing any work on the comics or directing or anything. It was all, he was basically just protecting Maya the entire time. And that's all he did. Like, even when he was doing those oil paintings, he had ghost artists doing them for him. And he would just put his signature on them. And then, like, every once in a while, he would make an appearance on a TV show or something. And, like, he would do a really basic sketch of Batman and then sign it and give it to him or whatever. It's just like, you know. And then, you know, I don't know. Just the impression I got from the whole thing was just like, he was such a douchebag and a dirtbag to his buddy.
Yeah.
And, like, I didn't ever think that before. But, like, you know, he spent his entire lifetime ruining that other dude's life, basically. I mean, building this, him and his buddy came up with this really cool, popular character that stands for, you know, defending truth and honor and all these things. And and secretly the whole time he's like, you know, his buddy's dying and in poverty and really sick. And he's just like, doesn't care.
That is wild. I mean, it's like the first time I've ever heard of any of this stuff. And it just blows my mind, really.
Yeah, it's like basically everything Batman's against is like, well, who is creator? Or his, like, his creator in name only is, like, you know, who he is.
Yeah. Just like that. That is wild.
I imagine I'll get comments tomorrow, like correcting my history on like everything.
I'm sure I got some. Now that I'm telling the story, I'm like, man, I should have probably paid a little bit more attention. Right. The whole time I'm like sweating like a pig trying to work out also.
Right. I know it's bad because it's like usually when I'm listening to like podcasts and stuff and people are talking about comics and they get stuff like that wrong, I'm usually like the guy yelling at the computer screen going like, no, you dumbass, you know.
It was 76, not 77.
Right. I'm definitely going to look that up on Netflix or wherever it is and try to find it and see if I can watch it.
Yeah, I seen it on Hulu. It's like a Hulu exclusive.
And, you know, like one other thing I was going to say, like when you're talking about ghost art, is like that's totally common, especially with like the older guys that did the newspaper stuff, was to hire ghost artists that were like, you know, uncredited and, you know, never got any credit. And basically that, you know, they weren't even like drawing their strips anymore. You know, I know like Frazetta worked on like Little Annie Fanny for like 12 years or something, just totally uncredited. And, it was like the same thing, you know, never got any kind of, you know, anything beyond just the page rate, you know.
Man, that is so sad. That's like depressingly sad.
Well, it's a comic book business, though. It really, I mean, it's changed in a way, but it really still hasn't changed. You know what I mean?
Well, like like McFarlane, like I, like, you know, much more about all this stuff, the comic stuff than I do. Like he was working on Spider-Man for Marvel, right? Like I know that for a fact, right? And then he at some point pitched Spawn and they said no and he said, okay, I'm out.
No, that's not actually how it worked. What happened was, well, you see, that was their bitch back then. That was actually the bitch from like him and Rob Liefeld and everybody. It was that like, hey, I'm working on Spider-Man, I'm making you all this money. We want, like, you know, part of the royalties from this. We want, like, you know, to be paid for the money that this is making, you know?
So they're only getting paid, like, a minuscule amount, basically.
They were getting paid their page rate. I'm sure it was, you know, high. They were, like, the, you know, top artists at Marvel at the time. But basically, I mean, the way it actually worked, like, and, you know, like, I hear other people tell the story, and it's, like, sometimes I hear it, like, wrong. But I was actually there back then. I wasn't hanging out with those guys. But I was, like, you know, doing comics back then, so I kind of, like, knew the story. But what really happened was, like, when Liefeld did, and I can't remember what book it was. Was it, like, Youngblood or something? Whatever book he did for Image, like, his first book, he actually did that book for the company that I worked for, Malibu, and he made a deal with them where it was like, you know, because he was like a big time Marvel artist on X-Force or whatever the fuck it was, and he made a deal with them where it was basically like, I'll get pretty much all the royalties, like 90% of the royalties or something, but you guys publish this book for me. And then like that first issue was like, you know, it basically just made him like tons and tons and tons of money, because like nobody had ever sort of published a book. Like, nobody popular had ever really published a book outside of Marvel. Like, back then, they had, like, independent companies, but they were all really small. When Liefeld actually published that first, and I guess it was Youngblood, I don't know. Somebody will, like, say in the comments what book it was. It was, like, a big deal, and, like, all the comic shops, like, ordered a million copies, and it sold, like, a ton of, you know, copies and made him, like, a ton of money. And that's really what started Image. That was like when, you know, Todd McFarlane, him and Jim Lee and whatever his name is, Shadow, the Shadow guy, I forgot, was it Jim Valentino and the Savage Dragon guy. Then they all went into Marvel and then they like laid out their thing where they were like, you know, we want like more money and like, you know, some kind of like ownership in the characters or we're going to leave. And, you know, Marvel was like, see you later, you know.
And then they wanted ownership of Spider-Man too.
Well, I don't know about ownership, but they wanted like, you know, just they wanted some of the, you know, residual money that like Marvel made beyond like the page rate, you know.
Well, that's understandable. I mean, but if they're like,
and I think it might have been like some sort of, you know, like, you know what I mean? They wanted like, so late, like when Marvel's reprinting their comics, like now, you know, in 2000, whatever, they wanted to still be getting paid for it, you know.
Yeah. Well, that's true. I mean, so like, okay. So, well, I had always pictured them like I don't know anybody else you're talking about except for McFarlane, and I only know of him because you know he went on to make a toy company, and you know I've studied sculptures and stuff like that, and I know a lot of people who worked for him, and that's the only reason I even know his name. And then I was like, I found out after the fact that he even like was the creator of Spawn, and you know what I mean, and that he had a.
Yeah,
and then I found out that he did, you know, Spider-Man, and I like that Spider-Man.
Yeah,
so I don't know about anything about the comics or whatever you're talking about that those guys were pitching, but
well, they were like, you know, Marvel was like, no, you know, we're not gonna give you anything more than what you got. They were like, well, we're gonna leave, and then you know, then they formed Image, and so like. They all had to basically do their own books. So, like, but you know, Tom McFarlane came up with Spawn. You know, Eric Larson came up with Savage Dragon. Liefeld did Youngblood, I guess. You know, and everybody hates Liefeld now. Like, Liefeld's like the big joke of the industry. Everybody's got like this, you know, he's almost like George Lucas or something where everybody likes to pick on him. So nobody likes to ever admit that, like, he was actually the first one that went off and made all this money. Because I don't really think that Image would have ever happened if Liefeld wouldn't have done that, wouldn't have made all that money on that book. Cause I think that's what like, you know, Tom McFarlane and everybody, when they saw him do that, they're like, oh wait, look at this. We could actually leave and make a bunch of money. Before that, I think everybody was like, well, Marvel's the only game in town. Where do you go? You know, work for DC and get the same deal.
So, okay. So DC was still around. See, I had pictured them like running into, you know, Stan Lee's office or whatever. He was like, what are you guys talking about?
Yeah. See, I mean, Stanley, you know, Stanley is just like, you know, he's not even in the picture at this point. I mean, Stanley is just even like, I don't know what he even does now, but like, even back then, he was just like the figurehead, you know, like he had his name on the front of the comics and he did the, you know, the whatever that first little write up thing is in the comics. But I mean, he wasn't even really writing comics, and I don't think he was even an editor at that point, but he was still sort of like in the company. And you know, Stan Lee, it's Marvel, Stan Lee, but he wasn't like, he didn't own Marvel or anything. You know what I mean? He just was, you know.
Okay. I always thought he was like a co-founder, or I thought he was like some, he owns Spider-Man and all that though, right? Or does he not even own any of that?
No, Marvel owns Spider-Man, but he did, you know, create Spider-Man with Jack Kirby. You know, there's all this contention on who actually created it. And then like Fantastic Four with Jack Kirby. You know, and everybody says, like, they say the way it worked back then. I mean, there's two versions. You got the Jack Kirby version, which was pretty much like Stanley gave me an idea, and then I drew a comic, and then he came back and wrote the words. And you got the Stanley version, which is basically, you know, Stanley, you know, what's it called, invented the characters and everything and told those guys what to draw. You know what I mean? And so you got the two different things. And one of the reasons they say that is because, like, Marvel – back in the day, and you know, even like when I was doing comics, they had this way of writing that was called the Marvel way, the Marvel way of, you know, it was just called the Marvel way. And basically it was like they wouldn't hand you a full script where it was like panel breakdowns, like draw this, draw this, draw this, draw this, you know what I mean? It would basically be like a loose story that you fit into 24 pages, and then you would panel it yourself, and then they would actually rewrite the dialogue so that it would work with what you drew, you know. And it's a lot better because like the artist, you know, the artist is better at telling the story than the writer's going to be, you know what I mean?
Yeah, that's cool.
And so, you know, like that's a lot of why I think, you know, and so I don't know. I don't know if Jack Kirby, you know, did Spider-Man or if it was actually Stan Lee or, you know what I mean? It just depends on
who do you tend to believe, or do you even have an opinion?
I think they kind of co-did it myself. I mean, I'm always kind of more on Jack Kirby's side because he's an artist and Stanley's a writer, so I got to be on the artist side, you know. But I think
Stanley's not an artist at all. I thought he was like, I know Jack Kirby like drew all the original Spider-Mans and stuff, but
no, he just, you know, he wrote. Yeah. Well, no, Jack Kirby didn't draw Spider-Man. It was Steve Ditko did Spider-Man.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
Yeah.
But he didn't have any, Ditko didn't have anything to do with the creation of him?
Well, no, see, that's the same thing. It's like, you know, according to like him, it's like he was the one who created Spider-Man. You know what I mean? It's like Stan Lee comes up with the idea, and then, you know, the costume and everything else is
like Ditko,
you know.
It sucks. But
it's like, you know. Well, I don't see. That's the thing, is I think everybody was working at like a. I mean, you know, who knows? But it's like, to me, like, I think everybody was working at a company, and that's how they made comics. You know what I mean? The artists, like, you know, brainstormed the characters, they drew the costumes and stuff like that. But if somebody comes to me and like says, "Well, you need to draw, you know, whatever, Ant-Man or something," I mean, in some ways, it's like that's also part of the creation of Ant-Man. Him just telling me to do it, like going like. You know, he's got to be somebody who shrinks and gets big. You know, I don't know.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I kind of feel like, yeah, I think it's a collaborative thing, you know? But yeah, like the Image guys, though, like at that time, you know, Marvel and DC were like the big, big, big fish. And really, no, there was no company that ever got any traction against those guys. You know what I mean? Up until Image came along. And then Image just like totally... just broke the industry open and just let all these other little companies get a foothold, like Dark Horse. And I don't know who else was back then, but, you know, and then like they actually had competition, and, you know, like I think Marvel just was like, what the fuck, what happened? You know what I mean? It was kind of awesome, I think.
Wow.
You know, despite like whatever you think about those guys, I mean, I think that's, you know, that to me was like a, you know, it changed the industry, and I personally think for the better. But
yeah, geez, that's crazy. I didn't know about a lot of that.
Yeah,
it is a bummer though, man. That there's like, you know, when a character or a story or whatever becomes so big that people have to get in these big fights and court battles over. You know what I mean?
Yeah. But, you know, do you think, though, like, because I've thought this, too, and, like, when I was at Marvel doing my stuff, I drew, like, these, you know, I can't even remember what they're called.
I remember you telling me you did concepts for, like, you know, you did concepts right. For, like, you know, Small Soldiers or whatever.
Oh, well, yeah, for that movie, concept art.
Yeah, and if they would have taken some of it, you would have been, you wouldn't have got crap for it, right?
Well, yeah, I mean, but I do think they took part of, like, some of the designs, because, like, in the toys, there was, like, this one character that had, like, this little monster baby on his back or something, and, like, I had drew these character designs where it was supposed to be, like these two creatures that kind of, like, you know, symbiotic relationship, you know what I mean? Like, you know, I don't know. And I always thought, well, that could be part of mine. Who knows? But, I mean... it doesn't matter. But like when I actually worked for Marvel, I did these two characters in this book called the X-Men, Ascani X-Men. And one was, and I can't remember what the hell these characters were called, but one was this, like this little fairy chick that had like these robotic arms. And then like these other ones were, they kind of look like these pterodactyl machines. So they look kind of like they have this like long pterodactyl beak. And then they're all kind of, you know, just had, you know what I mean, machinery all over them and stuff. That was kind of like my shtick back then.
Yeah.
And I drew them, you know, there was no reference or anything. The art director gave me the, you know, what they were. And she told me, like, up front, it's like, this is, you know, like, I want you to, like, you know, make these characters. But there's, like, no, you know, because, like, back then it was a real touchy thing. People making like characters and not getting like royalties or having any kind of ownership. So she like was real specific about asking me like, do I still want to do it? Like, you know, cause this is the deal. And I was like, yeah, fine. Cause I was hungry back then, you know?
Yeah.
But I did do those two characters. But what I was going to say is like, you know, those, I don't know what happened to them. I did see like the pterodactyl looking guys became kind of like a bad guy in some of the other X-Men books. And I saw them from time to time. But it's like, you know, they get famous like Batman or anything, but it's just like, I don't know. Like, how would you even pay somebody, I guess? Like, how would you work it out? And especially when you get onto like movies, so like, you know, a movie like Up or something, and you got like all these designers trying to figure out like those first characters and stuff, you know? It's like, how would you have ownership to those those creators to like all these different, it's probably not a popular way to look at it, especially from an artist's point of view, but
like, you mean like how you can even split it up? Is that what you mean?
Yeah. Like on Kubo or something, like just imagine all the designers that worked on Kubo and being like, okay, you know, is all those designers can have a piece of that character, right? I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, I guess I don't know. I can't imagine, you know, obviously, well, just because you, well, I mean, if you hire an artist, does he, like, anything he does, is that ownership of, I imagine it would be, right? Like, if you were, like, hired a bunch of people to do some stuff for your movie, and they came up with some really cool ideas, but because of the fact that you hired them and they needed the job, that's, I mean, it was all under your flagship, right? So that's all your stuff.
I think it's sometimes different, but I think, yeah, like, you know, like, especially with like Disney and stuff, I think, yeah, it's like, you know, you draw stuff for them, it's theirs, and your art goes in the ball, you know what I mean?
Yeah, and like everyone's like spitballing tons and tons of ideas, and if something gets picked up, mm-hmm. like, yeah, yep, yours got picked up, that's great for the movie, thanks.
Yeah, but then like, you know, if you got like, you know, Mike Mignola, for example, you know, like, he doesn't have to give up Hellboy when he goes to the movies. They, you know what I'm saying?
I guess I wonder if it's different depending on, like, you know, how much that was borrowed or taken, or if you were on the clock or not, or.
Yeah.
You know, I guess I just don't know enough about any of that stuff. I would imagine that if you were working for the company and you came up with a design and it got used, that, you know, like at Pixar, they have tons and tons of artists.
Yeah.
I can't imagine that they're all getting slices of, you know.
Yeah.
They are, though. I mean, I'm sure it took more than just John Lasseter to come up with, like, Buzz Lightyear and Woody and all them.
Right. He probably didn't come up with any of it, really. Somebody drew that stuff, probably.
Yeah, or even if he did, like, I'm sure there's elements that are borrowed and taken from other places and,
right.
You know. I would imagine that, like, yeah, you're working for Pixar. So like, if, you know, if you're doing designs for the movie and it gets picked, then that's like, great. You can tell people like, yeah, hey, I designed that and that and that, but you're not, but don't expect right. don't expect some sort of outside cut. Right. You know, we wouldn't be able to make any money if we were paying every single person, you know, I don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's like that or not.
I mean, I'm not justifying it. For sure. And especially not like in comics where you got like one guy or three guys making a book or something. You know what I mean? To say yeah. like, well, you should just be drawn and you should never get anything. Like, you know, if they make a, you know, whatever, Mole Man movie eventually. I don't know about that. I mean, to me, like, that's pushing it too far, you know. But in some ways, though, it is kind of like the deal. And it's weird that everybody screams about like the old guys getting screwed over when, you know, I mean, I'm sure, you know, anybody at Lucasfilm is not, you know, whose name's going on that stuff, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I guess I don't know. I imagine, though, if it's like a smaller project like that, like a comic book where it's just a, you know, I mean, how many people usually go into a comic book? Like maybe five or something? Or is it more than that?
I mean, it can be anything, but like, you know, like your standard is you got a pencil or ink or maybe the colorist and then the writer, you know.
So I mean, I wonder if that would be a little bit, I mean, that to me that sounds like it would be a little bit of a different scenario then,
right?
Where it's a smaller project, obviously you can say, okay, you did all this, you did all that, and then like get higher, you know, a higher rank in the company or whatever, like, you know, I mean, you're not like just some, you know, hire on like intern or artist or something, like, you know.
But
you're actually doing a substantial amount of design and we're really benefiting off of that,
right? I don't know, though, you know, like, it's funny because like especially with like comics and stuff, it's like, you know, as far as like going up in the company and stuff, you know, I mean, it's all freelance, you know, it's like just from top to bottom, that's like, that's always the way the jobs are, you know.
So even like McFarlane and those guys, when they're in their heyday on Spider-Man, they were all still freelancers.
Well, yeah, actually, when they were at Marvel, they were, you know. And then when they go on to do their own books, you know, they're not. But, you know, like a lot of those guys went on to see, now that's a good question, like you know, just what popped in my mind. But you know, like when they went on to do their books for a while, they hired other artists to do work on their books. I mean, I imagine they probably were all just freelancers that they were hiring, you know what I mean?
Jeez.
I know, it's kind of weird.
So I mean, I wonder if that changes the rule then. If you're a freelancer, you're not really hired on directly with the company. But I guess they make you sign some.
Well, no, stuff. You're not. It's like an independent, you know, contractor.
Yeah, I bet they're still having you sign some sort of thing saying like, "Hey, anything you do here, you're a freelancer." Oh, yeah, for sure. But like, I don't know. That seems like a goddamn lawyer's field day, man. I don't know.
Yeah.
Like, how do you prove anything? You know what I mean? Like, how do you prove you did or didn't? I mean, without, like...
I think nowadays, you know, like, everybody's so more on it with the contracts. I don't think that anybody could go back kind of the way, like, Jack Kirby and them did and be like, hey, I created blah, blah, blah. I should get some of this fucking movie now. You know what I mean? I don't think anybody could do that anymore. Because I think it's just so, like, you know, companies know what they're doing. I mean, there's just, you know... Like a company like Pixar or something, they're not going to take any kind of chance to let anybody do that, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Jeez, that's rough.
Yeah.
It's like, it's crazy how like, it's crazy how like that kind of art is made, you know what I mean? Where it's like, you know what I mean? It's like, it's kind of crazy that like, I don't know what I'm trying to get at, but it, like people that like a big, huge property or character like that. And then it's like tough to nail down, like who's all responsible. And like, no one's really, you know, no one's really willing to like offer like, oh yeah, I did this and he did that. And it just seems like there's a lot of like backstabbing, at least like, especially just coming off of seeing that with what happened with Bill.
Yeah.
It's just like, man, that is like so dirty, dog. And then you like, when you see stuff like that, like you relate it to like, what would you do in that situation or whatever?
Oh, it sucked. But I mean, what could you do? You know?
Well, I mean, if I was Bob Kane, I definitely would not have done what I did, but.
Yeah. I thought you meant, I thought it was like, you know, Bill Finger.
Yeah. But I mean, like if even if you were him, either one, like what would you have done? Like how, obviously you're going to DC ain't going to do anything because the contract's already written and they have no clue who you are. You could just be some random weirdo from the street coming in saying, hey, I actually came up with Batman.
Yeah. You know?
So they're definitely not going to listen to you. What proof would you have? You know what I mean? When was Batman? Like, when was he made? Like 1920s or something?
I think the 30s, but yeah. It's a ways back there.
It's like, yeah, I mean, like, you know, I don't know. That's just like such a, Just to like your buddy too. I mean, buddy, someone you worked with and you know, right. you called a friend and you collaborated with and like you finally hit it off and you finally get something that's working and then you screw your buddy. That's just like sick.
Yeah. It's interesting. I mean, the way people, you know, do that though, you know, I don't know. Cause I would think that I would probably try to like, you know, just, I mean, give him something, you know what I mean? Get him part of like the creation if he helped me create it. But then I don't know. I mean, maybe back then it wasn't even, cause a lot of things like with these comics, you know, it's so like, you know, looking back, you know, retrospective, but you know, comics weren't even like a lot of comic book artists wouldn't even like sign their names because they were ashamed to be working in comics. You know, maybe those guys back then kind of looked at it like, you know, this is nothing. This is just going to be something that goes on for a month. And then, you know, we're going to be back on, you know, romance comics or something. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So,
well, I mean, when it gets to a point though, of like Batman being as big as he was, I mean, I'm sure everyone was like, hell yeah, I worked on Batman. You know what I mean?
Right.
I colored his cape every issue. I have Monaga covered his cape.
Yeah.
So I can't imagine that, like, you know. But I do remember, like, in that documentary, they say when he did finally see, like, the guy he wrote it with, he finally saw that he wrote, you know, that episode, and he watched it. He was getting ready to watch it on, like, his little 12-inch black and white or something like that. And, like, it's cool how the documentary is done, because it's, like, all drawn out like a comic book.
Oh, really?
In a lot of places. So they, like, show him, like, sitting in his little room, this little black and white TV, and the guy was like, no, man, come on down. And they brought him to the studio when it was getting ready to air, and they let him watch it on this, like, I don't know, like, 30-inch color screen or whatever. Yeah. So he was able to watch his, like, his name in the credits, and the guy said that he started to cry, and I was like, oh, geez, man.
That's cool.
I was, like, choking up. I was like, that's freaking... And then that just made me hate freaking Bob Kane that much more.
I wonder if, like, those guys, you know, that did the, like, the first animated series, if they had any idea about any of this kind of story, you know, or anything like that, you know? Because I know they were, like, you know, they wanted to, like, really do, like, a good Batman cartoon, and, you know, the people that were, like, involved with that had, like, passion for Batman and all that.
Yeah. Yeah, so I don't know.
It's just, like, interesting. But it, you know, to me, like, to bring him in as a writer on one, it just almost makes you think, like, was this, like, more of, like, common knowledge than...
Well, a lot of the people that worked on the comics, like, the guy who did the documentary found them. And, like, he went and was interviewing them, and they were all, like, super old.
Yeah.
And he was talking to them and stuff, and they're like, oh, yeah, we know Bill Finger. We know what he did. But, like, no one's going to listen to them either, you know?
Right.
And the only time...
Well, yeah, what do you do?
Yeah, I mean, you know. But the only time that he came out and, like, publicly talked was, like, at the first comic convention ever. And, like, this hotel, and they, like, had, they found an audio tape from it.
That's, like, wild.
And, like, they, like, he was talking about it, and he was on the panel, and he was like, yeah, I was designing his cape, and I was like, man, that is insane.
That's pretty wild.
It's a crazy, the whole thing is just insane, man.
Yeah.
It's a really good watch for sure.
Yeah, I'll have to check it out. Go hunt it down. There's this other show I was, like, watching. Right, I didn't get to watch it. It's just, like, a, you know, I got to see the previews of it, and then I haven't been able to find it since. I made a video about it a little while ago, where they're, you know, it's like the feud that the Frazetta kids had over, like, all the Frazetta art. Once, you know, Frank died.
I just seen that show you did on that, like, the other day, and I was going to ask you about that, if you had ever found...
Yeah, yeah. Somebody threw me some links, and I couldn't get them to work, and so I don't know if they ever worked or not, but I've been hunting it, and I don't know, I'm going to keep looking for it, but I just thought it'd be really interesting to see, because that's just such a big mystery, and nobody's really ever talked about it much, and I really wanted to hear, you know, who was actually the bad guy, or if there wasn't a bad guy. So.
Yeah, it definitely sounds like there's a bad guy somewhere. There always is.
Rosetta shouldn't have painted those damn paintings. Wrecked those kids' lives. I don't know. I could definitely see, though, you know, just being a kid and having, you know, a couple $1 million sitting on your wall. And, you know, it's like, what do you do?
Yeah. I'm
tempted to sell those too, man.
Yeah. What's dad? What's old Pop's legacy worth?
Well, you know, even beyond that, just like, you know, like, what am I going to do for $1 million, you know? And it's, like, just sitting there.
Yeah, I mean, that's true.
I can't make it. I don't know.
I definitely can't paint like that, that's for sure.
We've been going actually quite a while. Maybe we should jump off, so.
Oh, really? Have we? It doesn't feel like it, but that's what happens when you... get to go into one of these things. You go for a while and you look up again and 7 hours went by.
That's true. I got a lot of good work done. So thanks for coming on. And everybody out there who watched, thanks for watching. And I know that we didn't answer the chat much, but I did read it as it was coming by, so thanks for contributing. See you guys later.